thanks for the mug and the caramel, Tim. I have to admit, still relishing some of the Montana caramel that I had from gifting us there. So thank you very much. I do believe we are live. I want to just double check that we're actually streaming. Yes, we are. Prayerfully, you like my stained glass, colorful background this evening. Thank you for tuning in and being here with us for yet again another Preterist Power Hour. Our goal is to highlight the power and progress of preterism, all the while chasing after clarity, healing, and strategy. We pray tonight that that's what you get out of our program, that you are encouraged regarding the power and progress of preterism. And more particularly tonight, we're talking about the beginning of the Bible, Genesis, and how that works its way through the whole narrative from Genesis to Revelation. Obviously, if you're here, you probably know we're going to be talking with Tim Martin. I trust that you will gain some clarity. If you allow that clarity to resonate with you, you will have healing in your life, and you will be able to strategize with us on how we can help others gain that clarity and healing that hopefully you're relishing as well. Just as a matter of introduction, I'm Mike Miano. I get to be your host this evening. I am the director of the Power of Preterism Network. I also serve as the pastor here at the Blue Point Bible Church and publish some books and have some other ministry endeavors behind me that I'd love to share with you at a time that's more appropriate. You can learn more about the Power of Preterism Network and our various ministries by visiting powerofpreterism.com, or of course, you can follow us on Facebook at the Power of Preterism Network. I'm very excited to get in on our interview tonight. It's a Wisdom Wednesday, so I do want to share some wisdom with you this evening. But before I go ahead and do that, let's open in a word of prayer, appreciating the Lord's presence with us, asking and inquiring that he would lead us with clarity and good disposition of thought this evening. Let's pray. Mighty God, we praise you. We thank you for all that we have in you, Lord. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your sovereignty, your providence, Lord, all the goodness that flows from you. We live in a world, Lord, where not everything is roses and butterflies. There's a lot of bad things that seem to be around us. We thank you that we possess the true hope. We possess a peace that surpasses all understanding. We possess that which causes us to rejoice even in calamity, even in crisis, Lord. So we thank you. We possess love. We possess God. Lord, we thank you for all that we have in you. We are truly rich. You have given everything to us pertaining to life and godliness. In our discussion tonight, Lord, remind us of that. As we talk about the Bible, as we talk about theology, as we talk about ministry, remind us of all that we have in you, Lord, and impress upon us the requirement, the blessing, the burden, if you will, to bring that, to share that with other people. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, obviously, I mentioned it's a special evening tonight. We're going to be talking with Tim Martin. I had joked online. I said that this is our usual time of year, yet Tim checks in with us and tells us a little bit about what's going on in his work and what's going on in the covenant creation conversations. And I'm excited to get in on that. Before I do that, you know, we're in the season of Advent, and I've already mentioned Wisdom Wednesday. And if you're journeying through the Advent season, you know that we've already lit two candles. We've lit the hope candle, which should remind us of our confident hope, our sure hope that we have in Christ, ultimately the hope of glory that's been fulfilled through Jesus Christ, Christ in us, in his people. Then, of course, this past Sunday, we lit the peace candle. And for me, this has been a sad time as, you know, I have been calling for a ceasefire in the Middle East and really engaging a lot of that effort. And it's hard for me to celebrate peace when I see the things that I do on social media at every turn. You know, I'm fairly active on Instagram, which is all about pictures. And in a season like this, it's frustrating to see the pictures that are coming across the screen. However, we rejoice in a peace that surpasses all understanding, a peace that the apostles had even while they were suffering. That peace is what caused them to suffer well. We see this in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. We see this in Romans chapter 5. The charge for the church to be a people who suffer well, because we have a peace that surpasses all understanding. And of course, it's even more troubling to journey toward the third lighting of the candle this coming Sunday, where we talk about exceeding joy. And again, I'm sure most of us have heard this, that we're not talking about happiness. happiness is contingent upon circumstances, whereas joy is a disposition that's given to us, provided to us through Christ our Lord. So I do pray that as we celebrate hope, we celebrate peace, that you find yourself celebrating joy as we journey towards Sunday, this coming Sunday, and even after this coming Sunday, that you rejoice in the Lord. And I believe it's so important to be reminding ourselves of the difference between happiness and joy. So I wanted to just challenge you with that tonight. That was a part of a prayer that I lifted up in a corporate setting earlier today. So I wanted to just encourage you with that. However, I want to bring our minds to the scriptures. Another devotion, if you will, that I've been doing for the Advent season is reading a chapter of Luke a day. Obviously, there's 24 chapters. If you started at December 1st, by Christmas, you've read the entire Gospel of Luke, which is great, being that we live in a society that most folks call themselves Christians and don't read the Bible at all. So here I want to read to you out of the International Children's Bible. I think it's safe to say that most folks know why I've taken to reading the International Children's Bible in my life more recently. So I've been reading my devotional through that, and I'm just going to read Luke 13, verses 1 through 5. And here it says, "At that time, some people were there with Jesus. They told him about what had happened to some people from Galilee. Pilate killed those people while they were worshiping. He mixed their blood with the blood of animals that they were sacrificing to God. Jesus answered, 'Do you think this happened to them because they were more sinful than all others from Galilee? No, they were not. But if all of you don't change your hearts and lives, then you will be destroyed as they were. What about those 18 people who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them? Do you think that they were more sinful than others who live in Jerusalem? They were not. But I tell you, if you don't change your hearts and lives, then you will all be destroyed too.'" You can see why I favored the International Children's Bible for that reading. I thought it makes it very simple. We are not to think that we are better than other people, no matter their circumstance, no matter their bloodline, no matter their sin, the things they struggle with. We are not to think that we are better. We must change our hearts and our lives to reflect the grace, the goodness, and the glory of God. That's what I want to challenge us with this Wisdom Wednesday. And I believe that if we just do that, just that alone, has propensity to change everything, change the world. Just being a people of grace, goodness, and glory. And what does it mean to be a people of glory? It means to carry the weight of all that God has done within us so that we might live it out, that it might be, you know, expressed through us, and that others might actually feel it and see it. It would be heavy upon them. Might I challenge us to display the grace and goodness of God in a fashion that others would say, "Wow, that's heavy. I almost feel like I need to pray again for us." However, that's just my thought. I want to encourage us to be living lives and thinking in ways that reflect the grace and goodness of God. So now to flip the script here, I'm excited to get into our interview with Tim. And, the last time I had Tim on our program here on the Preterist Power Hour, I felt like I knew him. You know, I talked to him a lot online. We've emailed each other. You know, we've been in touch for over a decade. However, now I can actually say I know him. I've met him. I've shook his hand and, had conversation in person, shared a meal. Now I know Tim Martin, and I'm very grateful for that, and I'm excited to get in on our interview. It was funny when I arrived in Missouri, and Tim was there with Amy, and, I walked up, and I felt like I was meeting with my brother and sister that I've, my long-lost brother and sister. Meanwhile, we'd never met in person, so it was pretty neat, and it just shows how neat the internet is and social networking and all that we have. So it's been a blessing to fellowship with Tim, to learn from Tim over the years. And if I may just lean in on one thing before I bring Tim in on the program here, I offered up a challenge or a question, if you will, on the Power of Preterism Network. What is your favorite chapter of Beyond Creation Science? I want to have folks thinking about that. I'd love to stir some conversation about that on social media, maybe get us talking about the book, maybe get some folks actually reading the book. I know a lot of people argue about the book that have never read it, which baffles me. So let's get folks to read the book, and you can even read it free online. So there's really no excuse at this point. My favorite chapter is chapter 21, I love the chapter on the Christian worldview. It's been a chapter I've referenced, I've talked about, I've talked to people about before. And I just want to share a little excerpt from that chapter. Right at the beginning of the chapter, where it talks about the Bible. Oh, I lost my page already. One second here. There we go. First, and perhaps the most importantly, preterism changes how Christians think about the Bible. I think we would agree with that. Then, as you journey further in that chapter, it talks about the kingdom of God. That's my favorite portion, to be frank here. One of preterism's most significant conclusions is that God's kingdom has been established on planet Earth. The kingdom has come, but only those in Christ can see it, John 3:3. The fact that the kingdom is primarily invisible does not mean that it is not here on this earth, nor does it mean that the effects of God's kingdom do not manifest themselves in visible ways. Amen. And, you know, there's a great portion in that chapter that talks about life in God's kingdom. I'd encourage you, just off the benefit of how we are to read the Bible, how we are to live in the kingdom of God. And thirdly, one of my favorite portions of the chapter is talking about missions and evangelism in the kingdom of God. And I just want to go ahead and read to you this portion a little bit more extensively than I did the others. Sorry, bear with me. My computer's just being a little wonky this evening. Proving to me why I'm usually a hard copy type of guy. I just have a book in front of me. It's a lot easier than playing around on the internet. Okay, so here we go. A covenantal view of the Bible has many implications for the future of evangelism and missions. The very first point to understand is that preterism shows that the Great Commission Jesus gave to his disciples was fulfilled in the first century. Jesus sent his disciples into all the world, and they went into all the world. Notice what Jesus prophesied before his ascension. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses into Jerusalem, into Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And I'm not going to get into all the details there of, I think we've all heard it, Matthew chapter 24, verse 14, Mark 16, 15, you know, and all the terms, whether it's ghee, that, you know, the gospel will go to into all the land, or the gospel will go to every creature. The gospel will be proclaimed to all nations. And we've seen that those are also found in apostolic literature as fulfilled. Pushing a bit further into that chapter, I want to read this portion here. It says, the Christian goal for missions must be nothing less than the complete conversion and evangelization of our planet through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Christians need to begin pondering long-term strategies that will bring this goal into reality throughout the work of individuals, families, churches, societies, hemispheres, and beyond. One concrete example we might offer relates to Islam. For more than 1,000 years, Islam has been in conflict with Christianity. Some of this conflict has been caused by bad Christian theology. Some has been caused by Muslim aggression based in the Quran's imperative of conversion by the sword. The overall trend has been toward escalating violence. We now have more than 1,000 years of history to the conflict with very little to show for kingdom growth from within Islamic countries. Indeed, Islam is one of the fastest growing religions in the world today. What about the future? Simply put, Christians need, and this is the part I want us to take in as a Wisdom Wednesday right now. Simply put, Christians need to develop and embark on a 1,000-year plan to convert Islam to Christ. Islam will continue to be in conflict with Christianity until this goal is accomplished. It is a violent religion, but Christians in America, at least, have not always handled the challenge with gospel wisdom. Christians should think long and hard about their futuristic views and the foreign policies that they tend to encourage that impact the relationship Islam has with culture and societies influenced by Christianity. When Christians in America give up their futurism and rethink their politics influenced by the last days, thinking especially related to Middle East conflicts and the modern nation state of Israel, they will again be in a position to make serious progress, for the kingdom of God. Christians need to focus on the radical conversion of Islam to biblical Christianity and subordinate their views of foreign policy to that goal. It is difficult to foster mission progress in Muslim countries when violence and war characterize the relationship between the Muslim countries and the West. On the other hand, better relations, trade, and cultural interaction between Muslim countries and the West will open doors for future mission work. Preterism, again, power of preterism. Preterism provides the theological framework and time perspective necessary for the accomplishment of an amazing goal, the conversion of our entire planet Earth to Christ by the power of the Christian gospel. I mean, what could be more timely of wisdom that we need to consider as many of us are watching the media and maybe even engaged in some effort. So, thank you, Tim. I'm very excited to get in on our interview today. So I will encourage you to unmute your mic and we'll welcome you back to the Preterist Power Hour.
Thank you, Michael. And I appreciate that introduction. And I know Jeff Vaughn has talked about that chapter 21 as well. And he had input on that stuff, but we were talking about the dispensational issue as far as the dispensational effect on foreign policy for the United States 20 years ago. And, here we are.
That's an important point that the book wasn't written after October 7th. The book wasn't written after, more recent events. This book's been published for quite some time. So definitely wisdom that needs to be considered and unfortunately hasn't been considered rightly. And that's why we find ourselves exactly where we are.
You know, let me touch that again, because the very first edition was the winter of 2001. And I did write it in the context of September 11th and 9/11. So I drew the issue there with 9/11 as blowback from Zionist foreign policy, which was a very unpopular view back then. And, people called you unpatriotic for bringing that out. But here we are once again.
No, and I'm glad you brought that up, because again, it just shows that if we act in ways that are, corresponding to war and violence, we're going to continue to see the realities that we have. And, so I definitely appreciate the wisdom that is in the book Beyond Creation Science. I appreciate that after 9/11, you did see some of the issues there. And unfortunately, they might not call us unpatriotic at this point, but trust me, there's plenty of names. They're still calling folks that are endeavoring toward peace in the Middle East region. Well, Tim, now we know each other officially in person and got to do the handshake.
Yeah, well, thank you. Thank you for the invite to the conference, Michael. We sure enjoyed coming over there. And I want to tell the audience that Michael has been inviting me to this conference at Blue Point Bible Church for years. But I always turned him down for one reason or another. And I think you changed your dates from where you started doing that conference, because we have a farm here in Montana. So, my schedule of the year is sort of nailed down when I can leave and when I cannot leave. And I know that there was some date issues there with the farm work, that my responsibilities are here with the family, and the farm just would not allow something like that. So just as everybody knows, Michael's been inviting me for a long time, but this year we had a really big breakthrough here on the farm and in our businesses here this year. I feel really good about what God has done in blessing our situation. I have a son, a 21-year-old son, who joined the main business that we have in Montana as a partner. And, my kids have all worked for me for many years. And usually they work for me for a few years as, crew management and type stuff. And then they move on to something else that they pursue, computers or whatever. But my 21-year-old son says, you know, this is a really, really good life. He likes the numbers that are in the business and the potential for the business. And he decided he would join up as a partner for the long term. And that's a real breakthrough for me because, you know, running a multiple businesses at the same time simultaneously with the family that I have and everything, the responsibilities that are on my shoulders, it sort of limits, you know, because I prioritize those things as a top of my responsibilities. So it sort of limits how much travel I can do and conferences I can go to. And, you know, we haven't actually had a formal covenant creation conference since 2010. So, I mean, we did have the Preterist Power Hour in last year that basically stands in as a conference group because we had so many different interviews and so many different people contributing. And there was a lot of progress made there. So I kind of count that as like that conference feel to that. So that's where we are now. And then I was able to meet you not once, but twice on the same year. So it's a breakthrough year, man. It's awesome.
Yes. Amen. Praise God. Yeah, you know, and that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to double back a bit and have you share some of your thoughts, you know, from the Ask the Pastor conference, which, you know, Pastor Steve, he continues to be a great messenger for the, you know, the truth of preterism. I see he's really been on top of the Israel-Palestinian conversation as well. So I'm very appreciative to him for that. And so I wanted to bring your thoughts back there. You know, here's some of your post-conference thoughts from Missouri, from New York. And then we'll jump in on some of the more recent developments that you've been working on as well.
Well, I want to thank Steve for giving me the invite to go to Missouri in August. I think it was second half of August. But I've been sort of listening to Steve for a while, and it just blew me away how fast he picks up these preterist ideas and application. And we were talking about covenant creation because he had a lot of questions early. He gave me the invite to go to Missouri, and you had said you're going to give me the invite for New York. So I figured, you know, the whole thing was, it was kind of neat because his conference is more of a beginner's conference, an introduction to end times Bible prophecy. And your conference, you've been teaching advanced preterism stuff and covenant creation and related stuff related to beyond creation science for more than a decade now, I think. I don't know exactly when you started, but it's been a long time. So I figured, you know, since I've been studying all these years, working on my own issues in the background and, you know, putting together notes and developing questions that I had that are still left over from beyond creation science, because that was more introductory and raising questions and pointing a direction, a different direction without giving all the answers. So I've been working on those issues that are in my mind, questions that have bothered me for a long time. But I took this year and I saw this year as one big unit option, right? So if you take your conference and Steve Magua's conference, you put them together, I could have like a series of presentations that each build on each other to sort of lay out kind of where I see covenant creation developing. So that's kind of how the big picture of how I saw it. And it was the perfect layout in God's providence, because the first session is really basic introduction to biblical hermeneutics, which Steve Magua asked me to do. And that led obviously into, you know, sort of some symbolism in the Bible, the way the Bible uses symbolism, and that set it together, that idea of covenant population that goes through scripture. And then I sort of took a big picture in the second presentation called A New Improved History of the Covenant Universe. It's sort of a big picture view of Genesis chapter 1 mainly. We sort of made some connections elsewhere, but Genesis 1 was the big picture for those new preterists, to sort of offer them an alternative to, you know, the way they think of Genesis 1 as futurists. So those two sessions work well together. They build on each other, and they start with kind of more basic covenant creation ideas. And then I went to New York, and it was like, well, then we deal with more involved issues like Adam and Adam's relationship to the rest of the Bible. And at the second session in New York was really sort of the capstone and conclusion of that four-part series The fourth session was titled The Gospel of Sin Management or Covenant Redemption Faith. And I was kind of giving the theological implications as I see them for covenant creation. And that's kind of a big job, but at least I was looking at it, you know, as a four-part series spread over two different conferences. And I apologize because I feel like the response that I got was, I mean, you got brand new preterists in Missouri, right? So it's like throw them in the deep end. And then I come in with like 12 years worth of notes and study and stuff, and I dump it at Blue Point. I mean, we have a mine over here in Butte, Montana, where they use these huge dump trucks, right, to haul the ore from where they dig it up to the processors and stuff. And these monstrous mining trucks, Butte mining is like, goes back to the 1800s, and you know, it's the richest hill on earth and stuff. But these tires on these things, they have to use semi trucks to haul these tires to deliver them to the mine to put them on these trucks. And I feel like, man, the response I got was like, I just brought this big dump truck of stuff, backed it up to Blue Point and just dumped it on everybody. Because it was like, what? a lot of people in Blue Point, I just felt like they didn't even know what questions to ask. So anyway, that's the way it was for me. That's kind of how I looked at it. And now I've got some ideas of what to do with that. So we'll talk about that too.
I want to dig in on that a bit. And, you know, I wanted, by the way, I realized as we were talking here, there was another breakthrough. The other breakthrough was that every other time we've had you on the Preterist Power Hour, all we got to do was hear your voice. So now you're good on the screen. Forgot about that. This is all new, you know, having you on video and having you join with us. So that's great. And, you know, obviously there's a lot more you could do with video than you could do with audio.
Sure.
You know, so that's a great, great thing. And I will say, you know, I did notice, I'll keep us at the Ask the Pastor conference for a moment here. Yes, you know, a lot of the folks there were new to preterism, which there's pros and cons to that, right? So sure. The pros would be, they're going to listen. You know, they're not right. Going to have all these immediate arguments, and they're not going to be so set up to argue against covenant creation, right, or different things like that. They're still in that learning mode where I'm going to take all the information in. And, you know, I would say that there did seem to be some confounded minds there. However, I will admit, you know, that was one of my favorite conferences I've ever gone to, because on Saturday night,
it was amazing. It was amazing.
The group, right? Everybody just broke into these groups and we're talking about, you know, I'm sitting at a table talking with about five people about how we can help Africa.
Uh-huh.
A better understanding. I'm like, man, we've got problems in America. You know, we're worried about bringing it over there. But again, it was just so beautiful. And then there were very comprehensive. And that's when I think about covenant creation. Yes. I think about it's a comprehensive, you know, worldview thing. That's what it's doing.
Right.
And, you know, I love what Dallas, you know, Dallas is here with us, and he often brings up that we have to understand, you know, the beginning of the Bible to, you know, understand the rest. And obviously that's a big part of beyond creation science as well. So, and people seen that. That was one thing I did get from the crowd,
yes,
in Missouri, was that they understood this is something that we need to grapple with so that it'll help change, you know, not only our theological views, but the things that are happening in real time. And I think that was part of the,
I think what I heard from the group in St. Louis were like this ongoing chorus of aha moments. It was like, oh, that makes sense. that was what I got from them. And it was like popcorn, you know, once it starts going, it just starts, that's exactly how I felt, like, you know, at St. Louis with Steve. And Steve was doing great work too. I mean, it was awesome.
Yeah, there was such a gracious crowd. I'll say that, you know, the gracious crowd, they listened, they were attentive, they were intelligent, which really blessed me. You know, right, people were asking me things about my presentation that I hadn't even thought about when I put together the presentation. So that was exciting. And, you know, I did appreciate your presentation there, because you brought it down to the basics of the word world, right? The way that we understand as preterists that, well, the word world doesn't mean world, you know, that when the Apostle Paul said that the gospel has been preached to everyone in the world, We don't suppose that before 65 AD, that, you know, everybody on the planet had heard the gospel. And I thought that was a great place to start to get people thinking, well, then how is that going to
influence
the way I'm reading the early parts of the Bible, where most people say this is about the beginning of the world? So, and then, of course, I thought the Anthropos, I think, right? Anthropos.
That was the springboard, because once you realize that mankind in the New Testament, particularly in prophecy, has a relationship to Israel, then you've got like an in to sort of unfold that all the way across the scriptures and the story of Adam being God's son, which, of course, Israel is called God's son as well. So I thought that, you know, once you can get someone to a preterist view of the book of Revelation, the door is open to go through on that issue of Adam. And that's a big part of where I view this progress in the most recent material with covenant creation.
Yeah, amen. And I did find that to be very beneficial, talking about, you know, how Adam could possibly be the beginning. And I've talked about that for years on my programs, you know, where Adam's the beginning of Israel. And, you know, let's consider it. Let's just put it on the table and see how that works out with the rest of the narrative as you journey right. toward Revelation. And I found it obviously gives me far less questions than, you know, confusion than my previous thoughts.
Well, let's circle back to Beyond Creation Science, because that's one issue we did not deal with very much in Beyond Creation Science, because it was sort of, you know, kind of murky and sort of definitely controversial at the time. So we left that issue off, you know, off the table, because there were more pressing Genesis creation type stuff issues to deal with.
You know, and what I also wanted to admit is that even for me, you know, somebody that, as you mentioned, you know, I consider myself somewhat seasoned in preterism and even in covenant creation conversations. However, when I listen to you speak at, you know, the Ask the Pastor conference, I have a whole host of notes. I didn't, unfortunately, bring them to the location I'm at right now. However, I did take a lot of notes. There was a lot that, you know, needed to be unpacked. You know, there was a lot of great stuff. However, even as I sat there, I was thinking, you know, I did look around the room a couple of times. I was like, man, if I'm taking this many notes and I'm sitting here like, wait a minute, you know, I'm wondering about the rest of the people around me. So I'm glad that we have some ideas to kind of break that down a bit more and get people thinking.
I've been stuck in Montana for 10 years, 11 years. Somebody let me out of my cage.
Fair enough. I totally get it. And by the way, I did want to double back to, you mentioned the 2010 Covenant Creation Conference. That was done in Fort Myers, Florida.
We did that conference entirely online through a radio station, an internet radio station called 8070.net. Yes. And that was actually ran by Michael Loomis at the time. And he was doing Don Preston's material. He was doing a lot of other preterist shows and stuff. And it was a listener supported enterprise, and it lasted for a few years, but, you know, I just, one of those things that everybody kind of moved on. So it was entirely internet based before Zoom. And we did it all online.
Okay. And those are, I believe we have them uploaded actually at the Power of Preterism blog. I might dig them up a bit later and encourage folks if they want to journey back to some other covenant creation conferences. And
it's on the front page of Beyond Creation Science as well.
All right, cool. There's the resource, beyondcreationscience.com. And so now let's flip that script here and then talk a little bit about Blue Point. So you came to Blue Point, and as you had mentioned there, you know, you talked about Adam. You got in on that conversation, right? And how that's going to relate to the rest of the Bible, which I don't know a Christian alive that wouldn't see that as important to understand how that relates to the rest of the Bible, the story of Adam. And then, and I surely agreed, and I thought of Ward when I read your fourth title there, The Gospel of Sin Management, you know, and then Covenant Redemptive Faith. I know Ward does a big thing, always talking about, you know, the old covenant was highlighting sin. It was all about sin and showing that man cannot maintain or manage sin, that, you know, unfortunately, the law magnified it. All men had it. And you know, Ward does a good job in teaching about, you know, the problem with a sin management gospel, which is no gospel at all. And then, of course, you were contrasting that. If I might ask you to explain to us, what would be a covenant redemptive faith? How would you explain that?
Right. So I agree with Ward about the problem of a gospel of sin management, but it's not just, you know, preterists that are talking about this, because I gave a reference from Dallas Willard and the divine conspiracy, which he kind of gets into it. But here's the problem, Michael, is that with futurism, everybody has the history that we live in now as the church age as being in the old covenant, right? Because they're living in the old heavens and the old earth. Well, if the nature of the old covenant is sin management, then you cannot escape that as a futurist. You have a perpetual old covenant until the consummation. And then you've got heaven, you know, that we're all going to, whatever that means. So the problem that we have is the eschatology of futurism is always intertwined with soteriology and all the other aspects of theology. So we're living in, you know, the leftovers. If you really want to get into it, we're really living in the downstream effect of Augustine, because Augustine really developed our framework for theology from his assumptions about Genesis creation. Of course, Augustine believed in a material creation, very symbolic approach to Genesis creation, but it's a material creation because Augustine had a material futurist eschatology. So that's what we're really bumping up to here as preterists. We're talking about living in the new heavens and new earth, but we all have a theology and a soteriology of old covenant order. So these are the questions that I've been thinking about for the last 12 years. How do you get a new soteriology as preterists that are not living in the old covenant world, right? But we now live in the new heavens and new earth. So that was what that presentation was really designed to sort of introduce to people, this idea that we can have a biblical soteriology that is not old covenant based. And that's actually one of those things that preterism brings to the table, to actually solve some historic problems with Augustine's, you know, basic framework. And that's Roman Catholic, that's Protestant. I mean, Eastern Orthodox don't like Augustine, but they still have that futurism. So we're talking everybody here. This is the big dance as far as the theology goes. Everybody kind of, you know, gets stuck in their evangelical world as if that's the whole world. I'm trying to break people out and see the big picture, you know, that we're showing up as full preterists to a very big dance when it comes to Christian theology. And I think the best metaphor about this is, you know, there's that movie that huge in my upbringing was 1985, Back to the Future, right? Have you seen that movie? I mean, it's everybody. It's like it's known as the perfect movie, right? For the 1980s, it's the perfect script. I mean, you got philosophy in there, predestination, free will issues, but it's all the story of Marty McFly, you know, Back to the Future. And the connection there is that guitar scene at the end of the movie when, you know, he's got to get his mom and dad together, otherwise he ceases to exist, and the band member can't play because he hurt his hand. And, you know, Marty McFly starts playing on the guitar, Earth Angel or something, some oldie stuff, right? And I feel like preterism is sort of like Marty McFly showing up to the high school dance. And then, you know, something happens and they kiss, his parents kiss, and he comes back to full strength. And he takes that guitar, he starts playing Johnny Be Good, which is, you know, anachronistic for them. And they start dancing. Oh my, what is that sound? And the guy calls the record label, right? He says, "I got the new sound you're looking for." He sticks the phone out. I mean, that's preterism. We just showed up to the big dance and we're playing music that they have never heard before. Okay. And that's a problem. And of course, Marty McFly gets that guitar and he goes from Johnny Be Good and, you know, the Barry song. And by the end of it, he's doing Van Halen. I mean, the scene is awesome, right? It's like the perfect metaphor for preterism. And by the time he gets done, he looks around. He's like,
they're all shocked.
They don't know. There's the guy. doing this on the show. I mean, that's preterism. We just showed up to the big dance and we are playing music that nobody has seen yet, right? And they have no idea what we're doing. Of course, we're heretics and all that stuff, whatever. But that's what we're doing. We are showing up to a really big dance, and I'm going to do some shows on this with the YouTube stuff. With they're coming, but that's like the ultimate metaphor of what we're doing. We're playing Van Halen at the high school dance of the 1950s, and it's hard because nobody's heard this stuff before.
That's a really good analogy.
I know. I've been thinking about it.
Yeah, I'm saying, you know, because there's, you know, in a serious tone, there's something that we need to think about as preterists with that as well,
right?
Where we need to say, well, then how can we, you know, shock value is good, right? And right. Confounding people has its good moments. But then as we know, that we don't want to totally lose people,
right?
We don't want people to be like that latter part where they're like, you know.
But then Marty McFly finishes up by saying a famous line. But your kids are going to love it.
Right, there you go.
From my perspective, the metaphor works because what's going to come out of this is going to be here for the long term. And the kids are going to love it. So I'm willing to open up the experimentation and consider a lot of different things. And I agree with you. The most important thing is that we know history. We know what the old music is, right? Because that old music didn't just come like without any development whatsoever or no knowledge of musical theory or instrumental skills and practice and the structure of how to make great music. So we can't forget all that old stuff. And when I gave my introduction to the covenant creation on YouTube, that was what I was trying to highlight. We're trying to do two things here. We have an Amish cabin. We're trying to love the old construction, the ornate wood construction, the nice stout beams. And, you know, when they built this cabin, they didn't even wire it for power. I'm living in an Amish cabin, man. I mean, we brought power in and we've got, you know, power going everywhere, but we've got Starlink in here to do some really neat stuff that the guy that built this cabin had no idea of any of this stuff. So I think there's that balance that I was trying to highlight. There's a balance of understanding the old and appreciating the history of Christian theology. And there's the importance of making progress to solve some real problems with some futurist background in Christian theology.
Yeah, you know, and I obviously in more recent years, I think of you know, the conversation that Kim Burgess and Gary DeMar were having. You know, I think that conversation exposed some details as to how this has to tie back to Adam. Yep. Now we have to go, you know, we have to get past Abraham, keep going back to Adam. And,
you know, and Kim didn't want to do that. You know why Kim didn't want to do that? Because he was committed to Augustine. It was a block for him to think carefully. And so what he ended up with at the end of that whole podcast series was, well, there's the age of Adam and there's the age of Abraham and they're different. And he's got two ages going on, right? He was having this two-age discussion that was just total confusion. It actually refutes preterism when you get to Matthew 24:3, when Jesus says, the end of the age, according to Burgess, that's supposed to be the Adam age. And it's like, it doesn't work.
Yeah. So unfortunately, and that's the good thing about this conversation and about entering in on covenant creation is they realize that themselves. You know, Kim actually said in a message to me, I don't know why I did this. And I think, unfortunately, when you have faulty hermeneutics and faulty, you know, you're not being consistent, that's where you're going to end up. I don't even know why I began to do this. You're muted for some reason, Tim. Uh-oh. Yeah, you're muted. I'm going to mute you and unmute. Maybe if you unmute, it'll bring you back. No. I can see you talking, can't hear you.
How about that?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. With Kim Burgess, what Kim was trying to do, he's trying to take full preterist ideas and conclusions and marry them to Augustine's futurism and soteriology. When it gets right down to it, I mean, simple statement. And I think it showed at the end that it just didn't work.
Yeah, that's right. Which again, it's a great opportunity to pick the Bible up again, start back at the beginning, and let's be consistent. And
yep. Let's
see how this goes. So that brings me to my next question. You know, what are some of your ideas? I know you've developed this YouTube channel. What are some of the things that you're currently working on that I know you have a couple videos up now, about five videos.
Okay, so in getting the basic feedback that I got from the audience is that it's so much material. I realized I'm trying to think about the best way to communicate the details of this four-part series. So it really is a four-part series from beginning to end, and it's all connected and it's all like streamed, you know, strings that touch everywhere. So I was thinking about YouTube over the summer. And, you know, I bought the new computer so I can do some more stuff. My kids do computer programming, so I should be way more advanced on computer stuff than I really am. But my thinking about the YouTube was, and I asked a friend who just started doing YouTube last few months, I said, what do you think about this YouTube stuff? And it's like, you know, 2 weeks ago, he says, I really like it. And it seems to be effective. He's getting good results. So, and then he says, I think you should do it. So I took his advice and I started watching how to make YouTube videos on YouTube. And that kind of got addicting because I ended up watching 3 days worth of how to make YouTube videos on YouTube. And so I'm going to try to use this YouTube channel as a covenant creation on YouTube channel to really kind of archive that four-part series as my end goal this winter. But I'm going to try to do it in a roundabout way to where I'm using these front end videos to sort of introduce myself, to give people like, you know, almost like a safari where you're just basically giving them a tour of different theologies that is going to sort of introduce covenant creation to them a little bit at a time. And then I'll do an introduction to the four-part series. And then I'm going to do the four-part series in like 10 to 20 minute chunks, really bite-sized pieces. So right now I have between 25 and 30 videos all conceptually drawn out, and we're going to be getting to that series in a roundabout way as a sort of way of like, I wanted to build subscriber base too at the same time and good content that can be used. So, and I'm still new to it. I mean, I'm into my early second week, right? So I'm like eight days into it. So I want to learn how to get familiar with the technology as well. But at the end of the winter, my goal is to have those four presentations put together on YouTube so that people can evaluate them, you know, in bite-sized chunks. I mean, some of that stuff, there's like three slides. I could see a whole show doing, and just having a sequential playlist series through those conference presentations. That's my big picture. And of course, there's always stuff that you can talk about on YouTube. And I'm sure that will reproduce and stuff, but I have to go back to work in March pretty heavy with both my work schedule and my farm schedule. And that's the way it's been for me for 20 something years. We wrote Beyond Creation Science over like 7 winters, right? So it's like, all winter we'd be writing and adding, and Jeff and I were going back and forth and talking, and then we put the whole thing away, other than, you know, the random stuff that we find in the summer, and just put it away for winter. Winter comes again and I drag all that stuff back out and do a whole bunch more writing. So it's winter time for me. That's when I retire every year. I tell people my retirement is winter time. And then we go back to work in March, and we have a huge summer. Long hours from, you know, March through about Thanksgiving. We worked about 3 weeks late this year because we had a really nice warm fall. So I'm getting a late start on it, but I feel like we're going to get rolling, and I think we're going to go through that and produce that material here in the cabin and put it up on YouTube. But I have a method to my madness because I want to give people a tour of the current scene so that they can learn some ideas, some concepts, and see some issues that prepares them for the material. And I started with Max King, if you notice. That was like, I've wanted to talk about this for 15 years. But you know, I never got into Max King until relatively recently. So, you know, that was my first, I figured that's a good kickoff because that's something that will sit there and the Max King name is going to get people's attention. And then I laid out sort of an analysis of Max King on Genesis 1 that I still have the book. Nobody's won the contest yet. I mean, I couldn't find anything that Max King wrote on Genesis 1. And I've been looking for months and I've been asking people that should know. And I ran this contest. If you go to my YouTube, you'll see the contest. But I still have the book because I don't believe it exists. I don't believe that Max King taught one detail about Genesis 1. And the amazing thing about it is, if you look at it, is that, you know, Max King taught everybody that you can't just assume that the heavens and the earth is the material creation. When it comes to eschatology, right? When it comes to eschatology, Max King taught everybody that. And now there are people working in the Genesis side. John Walton. John Walton has just done exactly what Max King did for eschatology for Genesis chapter 1. John Walton has showed you cannot assume automatically that Genesis 1:1 and the creation of the heavens and the earth is dealing with material ontology. So here we have guys on Genesis saying, you know, this isn't about material ontology. And you got Max King, Mr. Covenant Eschatology, you know, and they need to talk, but they don't. The John Walton guys and the guys doing Genesis, they have no interest in eschatology. It's beyond them. It's like, that's not my field. I don't work there. I wasn't trained for eschatology stuff. And you got Don Preston, who writes on Genesis, but, you know, other than the death of Adam, I mean, does anybody have anything from Don Preston on Genesis chapter 1? It's just not his field. And I get that. You have certain talents and you have certain, you know, certain training and you have everything else, and that works out good because we're designed to be focused, right? So you have your specialty. Well, Don Preston's specialty is eschatology. John Walton's specialty is Genesis creation stuff. And I'm over here saying, guys, it's the same issue.
It really is, you know, and I did want to just say to what you were saying about seasons, you know, I think it's good that you live your life in seasons. I think life is best lived in seasons. That's, you know, Ecclesiastes, by the way, you know, and we need to live like that. So I'm grateful for that. And, you know, I totally agree. I think what we're seeing, we're living in the day of cross-pollination, you know, where yeah. We're seeing these conversations leaking into other places. And I also think there's people being willing to do the work. You know, it's sometimes hard to go into a room where, you know, everybody's going to disagree with you at first, right? I think that's what the burden that we carry is, you know, and I did want to say, you know, shout out to the boroughs of Berea because they're doing a big part of that. I know you have the shirt on. And
yes,
the reason
sir.
I say that is Rick Welch actually was the one who brought that term up to me a couple months back, cross-pollination, that we need to see more of that within the preterist community. And I believe it's the same thing with the covenant creation conversation. You know, and to double back to what I was saying there, it's hard when, you know, here I am, I'm working right now in the Israel-Palestinian conversation. It's safe to say that most people that are engaging this conversation from the perspective I am, which is to know faces, to actually know people in the land, to talk about the stories that are happening in the land, not taking sides Israeli-Palestinian, but being a Christian. Unfortunately, what I'm noticing is most people that are engaging that work have never heard of preterism, and I'm willing to bet they've never heard of covenant creation. So it takes work because now I have to put myself into this world where these people know nothing about these different vantage points that I actually believe are very important, you know, in this conflict, in dealing with this conversation. So what ends up happening is we have to be willing. That's the first thing it's going to take, is a willingness to say, I'm going to put myself around people that might disagree with me, and I'm going to act polite, you know, or, you know, I'm going to act like a Christian, where I'm going to have conversations with people. Someone asked me the other night in regards to the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. They said, you know, what would Jesus do? And I said, well, one thing I know Jesus would do is he would go to a tax collector's house and he would invite a Pharisee. Yeah. That's what he did. That's Jesus' story. So look what he did. He went into a place that was considered, oh, no, we don't go there. He went there, was willing to have conversations, and he even brought somebody that he knew would totally disagree with this whole thing. And think about how we should be doing that. We need to be going to dispensational, you know, conferences. We need to be going to John Walton conferences and engaging, you know, obviously these days, the good thing is we don't have to do it all in person. We can do online efforts, engage the online efforts of these people. And that's what we need. We need to see more people being willing to listen to, you know, not the John Waltons of the world, but the Tim Martins of the world, and seek for consistency, demand consistency, you know, in regards to Genesis to Revelation. And the good news is, I believe, and I sense from your excitement that you believe it as well, that we're there. We're seeing this happen.
This is happening every day for me in my line of work with Covenant Gardens, our farm here. We're seeing the very same issue. We are dealing with what is called regenerative agriculture. And that's sort of the methods of which we farm. It's sort of a cutting edge thing. It's sort of like the old organic farming has gone like to a whole new level, even beyond organic. I mean, it's not even organic in the traditional sense. But we are running into conventional ideas that if you think about where the ideas come from in our society, they come from Christian doctrine and culture and particular literal readings of Genesis about taking dominion, about how the earth is cursed and that weeds, you know, all the weeds in the world happen because Adam sinned. That is a cultural paradigm that is a direct descendant of Christian theology, old futurist Christian theology. And we're coming at this with the regenerative agriculture, and we're seeing that that whole paradigm is completely false. And really, regenerative agriculture is preterist view of Genesis, the preterist view of the curse applied to agriculture. And I'm seeing this cross-pollination between the theology of preterism and the work that we do on the farm. It works like this. And let me talk, you talk about worldview stuff, you know, industrial agriculture around the world. There are implications for that for our preterist theology. And I'm out there talking to it. Now, it's the same thing like what you're saying about the people that are doing that. People that are doing that understand the background in Christian theology, and they want to have nothing to do with Christian theology. Because to them, that's where people got the idea to abuse the earth, right? Just do clear cut everything, tear up the ground, grow crop after crop, starting with tobacco, wear out your soil. And then when you run out of soil, you just move west, right? That's the dominion idea. And we are living in a lot of bad news effects of that. We don't even understand it with our diseases, with our illnesses, with our pollution, with our habitat loss and stuff. So the people I'm talking to, obviously they're not Christians. But they're doing really good work on the actual soil biology and the actual regenerative agriculture. They know their stuff. And then I'm coming in here and I'm like, I've got the theology for that. So it's like this farm, this Covenant Gardens, is just an application, like a real world application of preterist theology. Covenant Gardens is the outgrowth of covenant eschatology. So we can go talk about this cross-pollination stuff. It's just unbelievably amazing. And I'm excited about it, just like you. You talk to the people and you see the excitement. And you see, you know, we have real-world solutions, man. World-changing stuff. And people just don't even know. It's just unbelievable to me. Sorry, I mean, I don't want to ramble, but that's my position.
Be excited, brother. We should be excited. Amen. And I totally agree, you know, and I'm glad you brought up the Covenant Gardens, because I did notice in our conference here at the church, I have some folks at Blue Point that are involved in, you know, agriculture and are interested in that type of, you know, conversation, namely one of our deacons. And I did notice his ears perk up when you began to mention that and have that conversation. I was able to remind him of some of the things you shared at the Ask the Pastor conference. So, you know, I definitely see that as just yet again, another inroad of cross-pollination. And I think that's beautiful that you're having those conversations with folks.
And the hard part, though, is that, Michael, that we as preterists come from fundamentalist background. So we have this this characterization is, oh, those are all the yuppie, hippie, nasty, pot smoking, evil people, right? You know, we're Christians. So there's this block. I mean, you see it with the Palestinian-Israeli issue and the whole foreign policy of America. I mean, you have this idea, well, if you're not for supporting Israel, you're not American, you're not patriotic or whatever, right? That's the conception of fundamentalism that we're all dealing with. Yeah. Well, that applies to a lot of other issues too. But if you bring up these other issues with preterists, it's like, oh no, I vote Republican. You know, it's Trump or whatever it is. And I'm not being political. I'm just saying that sometimes we see the block on the theology side when it comes to things like Zionism. But there's a lot of other issues, guys, that you don't want to see it because it makes you feel like a liberal, right? And you're more interested in maintaining your conservative creds than to work out the theology that God has given you for the purpose of transforming this world. That'll get me going, right? We're not fundamentalist anymore as preterists. So stop acting like it. Stop thinking like it.
Yeah. Amen.
There's something way better. And if you just get out of your shell and start thinking about it and start re-examining scripture, you're going to have the freedom to sort of see entirely new paradigms that you could not have imagined. And I'm only saying that because that was me 20 years ago, 10 years ago, right? And then I just said, no, I'm not going to live in this paradigm of fundamentalism anymore. And all the cheap answers and the false claims and the just black and white, like stupidity that they do. I'm going to study scripture afresh, knowing that the problems that we have today are a result of errors, and some of them are really old errors, but we can re-examine that. We're preterists. We're heretics already. Why not? Give it a try.
Yeah, that's what Origen thought in the fourth century there. He felt, you know, I don't know what we're saying about creation. Let's double back and look at it. Obviously, I don't agree with all of what Origen had to say about it, but he did. He knew that there was something not right with the way that they were connecting theology and protology, with Genesis there. And Origen, you know, he came up with obviously the allegorical method. And, it depends where I am on what day. If I'm, you know, sometimes I'm appreciative of Origen. Sometimes I'm like, oh man, he messed it up even more than, you know, we needed to. And I did want to go back to what you were saying about the Max King challenge there, because what I love about the challenge, I love challenges and I love free books. So, you know, you got my attention right there. However, what I really see you doing in that is giving people homework. You're bringing us all to be co-laborers in this conversation of consistency, where now, you know, and for folks that don't know, and please remind me, help me out if I'm wrong, but what Tim is challenging us to do, Tim had done a video on the Max King Challenge, and he shared a quote from Max King's book, The Crossing the Parousia of Christ. And then I love how you brought up that the table of contents, if you will, where, you know, it's like he has one, you know, Genesis 1:1, there's one page reference to it. There was a couple others to Genesis 2 and 3.
Yeah.
And what Tim had highlighted was, okay, so this is what he said about Genesis 1. What else does he say? How does he connect, eschatology or the rest of the Bible at all with the story of Adam? What did Max King say about Adam? Is that a good way to offer it up there?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of confusion in Max King when it gets beyond, before Moses and the Sinai covenant and the giving of the law. I mean, he sort of tries to define it all there, but obviously you can't, because you got circumcision with Abraham before then. And then you got Noah before Abraham with clean and unclean animals. You know, where the heck did he get that idea? And then you go back to Cain and Abel, and they're offering the first fruits of the flocks. Abel's offering the firstborn of his flocks. And that's what Israel was told to do, you know, in the law. So I think what I see was, looking at Max King, my conclusion is Max King was so focused on eschatology, he never even asked the question about Genesis creation. And that's why we can't find anything that Max King wrote about Genesis 1. That's an old dispensational idea. His idea is that Genesis 1 is an unconnected dispensation to us, you know, and And we're really connected to the fifth dispensation of law, and that's what's passing away in the at the end of the age. And by the way, that's an Israel, that leads to Israel only ideas. If you have the beginning of the creation as Israel and the law, it's really hard to avoid Israel-only conclusions. So I see covenant creation as not only solving the issue that Max King has, it also solves another issue on the other side with the Israel-only stuff, because we're talking about the whole creation in Genesis 1, which has more than just Adam. And that's where we go with it.
That's going to be one of those conversations that we have to allow one show for to develop. So I definitely appreciate that. You know, again, I would say that here I am, someone that I've been studying covenant creation for about a decade now, and I still have a lot of questions. I still have, you know, people bring up, that's why I love dialogue, because people bring up things that need to be considered. In our Q&A here tonight, I'm going to bring up something that that was brought up in one of our online platforms, actually just a little while ago. I'll challenge us with that. And hear your perspective. But again, I think that's the key, is that it's not being a know-it-all. You know, I'm in this season of, I'm in recovery of being a know-it-all. So I'm just continuing to grow and take in information and again, chase after consistency where I can. So when I hear that conversation about Genesis 1, actually I just participated in a chat with Dallas here. Dallas has a podcast called Challenging nice. Conditions of Men. And a podcast on just the first three words in the beginning. And I'll tell you,
I can see that for sure.
You know, and Dallas challenged me there, where I'm saying, you know, there's so much here, you know, and I do want to encourage folks, you want to check out Challenging the Traditions of Men podcast, just put it in Google. That's what I do. I use a new podcast site every time I listen. So, you know, which is cool, because then we're getting the ratings up on different networks.
Right.
But again, just listening to the first three words, I mean, come on now, the first three words of the Bible was a Bible study that I went to the other night, and I learned new things. I challenged in my study. So how much more? I mean, we're going to get into the first 10 words, you know, and it's just going to keep going. We need to be a people that are willing to admit, I don't know it all. And there's a lot more that I need to lean in on here, the study. So I'm going to be interested in when you develop that conversation about Max King and Genesis 1 and the dispensational problem, the Israel only problem, which I do believe is a necessary conversation for a lot of preterists. My ears will be tuned into that conversation. And I do want to encourage folks, go over to Covenant Creation on Google or on YouTube, excuse me, and we'll make sure we share the link and have everybody going over to the channel. Watch the Max King Challenge video. That way you can hear it from Tim when he had it, you know, right there on the video. And do your work. And also, you know, I might take up this challenge and offer this. Let's find out what Don Preston said as well. You know, let's dig in.
I'm going to be in the doghouse now. I'm causing problems now. I'm not a troublemaker.
No, you know, let's create conversations, you know, because I agree. I had Don in my car. I always talk about this. I had him in the car for about 45 to 50 minutes. You know, the ride from my area to the city.
Yeah.
And I had him in the car. And I hammered him, you know, what do you believe about hell? What do you believe about covenant creation? What do you believe about this? A lot of it, you know, Don was willing to admit, okay, there's something there that needs to be considered. Right. He kind of, to borrow a phrase somebody said to me recently, he said, I don't have the bandwidth to deal with that. Right.
Right.
You know, that's not really my area. I know that Don, let's face it, Don takes a lot of heat for the preterist community. So we should appreciate him for that. He's like, you know, do I really have to jump to the beginning of the Bible and take that heat too now? You know, I give him credit for what he's done. So I will, though, I want to see that. And I believe you're onto something here. If we can double back and figure out what we've said about Genesis creation, what our favorite Bible teachers, if you will, have said about Genesis creation, and how that's formed a paradigm for us, then we can begin to either see how it's consistent and it works, or say
There's a very important issue here, though, as well, is that we are discovering new material in the ancient Near East context, which goes back to the same part of the world and same time period that has been brand newly discovered in the last 100 to 120, 130 years. So if you start asking, what's the cultural context of Genesis chapter 1, right? until modern archaeology, there's been no knowledge of that. Augustine didn't know what they're finding in the ancient Near East stuff now. Calvin didn't know. You know, the reformed divines from Westminster didn't know. So there's a real development here that we have discoveries that are legit discoveries about the way the ancient Near East viewed the world, about their temple text and temple centrality to their society, that, you know, I'm looking at it as a preterist, like, yeah, well, that makes total sense. But, you know, that's new information that's coming into this whole conversation. And a lot of people don't even want to look at it. You know, and how does a preterist say, oh, cultural context of the ancient Near East, that doesn't matter anything about Genesis? You know, when we know you can't go to the New Testament without understanding Greco-Roman culture and history and politics and everything. I mean, you can't do that. Well, you know, the same issue applies to Genesis chapter 1 and the ancient Near East cosmology that's being, you know, talked about by people like John Walton and G.K. Beale and a bunch of other guys. So, and, you know, N.T. Wright is another one that's clued into this really big. So, you know, that's a different issue when you start finding new information.
New information should make us feel as though we should have new questions. We should have
absolutely
more digging to do. You know, that's what new information does for me, in the very least. It also causes me to remember that I don't know it all, and I need to be willing to listen
and
search things out a bit better. Or, to borrow the phrase I always bring up here on our program, seeking, searching, studying, and proving. Those are the things that we should be doing in our lives. That's our ethos that should emanate from us, that we should be a people that are always seeking after information. The Bereans, you know, I talked about this on a program recently. Most people focus on the fact that the Bereans searched the scriptures, and that's true. They did search the scriptures. However, what always baffles me is the Bereans listened. They were willing to and listen, you know, and then they searched the scriptures. Yes, but I think that's what's needed, is really just a willingness to do the listening. As you say, you know, new information has been brought in front of us from the 1970s. We need to be willing to say, okay, well, how did that information inform us? What should we be considering as Bible believing folks, folks that believe in context and audience relevance? Should that, you know, affect us? You know, Tim, I want to make sure I leave some time for people to chime in here and
sure.
some comments and questions. But one more question I wanted to ask you is, I didn't get a chance to listen to your most recent video. You said something about regrets. I was going to ask, what did you share in that video?
So I actually, you know, I'm trying to use the YouTube channel to introduce people to myself. So my regret, and if you're a pastor, you know, you learn stuff down the road that you taught on before, and you say, you know, I kind of regret teaching that detail. And if you've written books or any kind of material, you learn more stuff, and you have regrets that. So everybody has regrets, and my particular situation had to do with the fact that it has to do with Max King. It's a follow-up video to the Max King thing. But my regret has to do with that. If you go into the author index of Beyond Creation Science, you will not find the name Max King. And it's kind of embarrassing, because, you know, the reason it's not back there is because we didn't mention Max King in the entire book. The reason I didn't mention Max King in the book is because I had never read Max King as, you know, formal material, other than just, you know, the articles, or whatever. But I had never read a book by Max King until I bought the very first Max King book, The Cross and the Parousia, in Ardmore, Oklahoma. I think it was 2012. And, you know, Beyond Creation Science had been out for 3 or 4 years. So my regret is that Max King is not listed in the index of Beyond Creation Science as a contributor, because he did so much for covenant eschatology. And, you know, and really taking eschatology to a new level. And really, from a covenant creation perspective, you know, we can't really, it's kind of unthinkable to have covenant creation if you don't have covenant eschatology, you know. So that's my regret, is that, you know, and it was embarrassing. I just didn't study it. I was doing other things. And I talked a little bit about the history of, you know, the Church of Christ background and that side of the tracks versus the Reformed background and, you know, the Calvinistic side of the tracks. and how I came from one side of the tracks where, you know, we just didn't really pay much attention to the Church of Christ, Restoration Movement, Christian churches stuff. That changed for me 20 something years ago when Jeff Vaughn became partner and co-author, because, you know, we were working together across the tracks, you know, since 2001. So over 20 years now. So I kind of used the video as a foil to talk about that and some future for preterism. So, but the video's there, and it's kind of long because I bring in my past and my history to explain and sort of introduce myself to the audience of the YouTube channel.
I'm glad I asked about that, because, you know, that is very humbling that you would admit that. I appreciate that. And, you know, Max King surely did, you know, put a good foundation in front of us. And, you know, the joke would be, so wait a minute, you became a full preterist without reading Max King's book?
Well, I actually talk about that. And you know what, it's actually, there's benefits and bad things about that. But I didn't want to leave the viewers with the idea that I was just being negative about Max King with that first Max King video, because I wanted to follow up. And it's a perfect example of a good story lead. So that was my regret, is that it's completely omitted from Beyond Creation Science. And that was a mistake.
Yeah, so. Amen. I imagine that. And, you know, I said that facetiously in a way, though, because most people actually have not read The Cross and the Parousia of Christ by Max King. Most preterists actually have come to preterism. I mean, we've done interviews here on our program for years, and very rarely, does someone say, well, I read Max King's book and I became a full preterist, you know.
That's true, but Max King created Jack Scott, Kurt Simmons, Don Preston. So they're getting Max King indirectly. So you don't have to necessarily read Max King to get Max King, because Max King lives on in his children. And, you know, Don Preston is his firstborn.
I'm a great, great grandchild or something in that somewhere, you know, Alan Bondar, Don Preston, you know, somewhere that I trace back. But yeah, yeah. Amen. And I definitely appreciate Max King's work as well. You know, and I appreciate, by the way, I have to make mention of this. Larry Siegel has now taken up the position at Cortland Church of Christ, where Max King was preaching. I want to, of course, encourage folks to be praying for and appreciating Larry Siegel's efforts there in that congregation. I know I'm planning a trip. I want to visit Cortland, Ohio, and you know, learn more about the Warren, Ohio, for that matter, the Cortland Church of Christ. So, yeah, Tim, I'm going to unmute some mics. Let folks.
Absolutely, sounds good.
And then I'll bring you back on here to give us some last or concluding thoughts. If your mic is unmuted and you want to jump in, share a comment or a question, please feel welcome.
Yeah, I'd like to make a fast comment. The full preterism needs to continue to reform. Reformation is always necessary, because, you know, what we've heard in the past, and the giants from the past are very good and very helpful and beneficial, but we can't stay there. We have to continue learning, because the Bible, you know, continues to give us, you know, further insight. What I have here, you know, basically is judgments on God's people for perverting his word and ordinances. Jesus' method was the sword that came out of his mouth, which is the gospel of the kingdom. Then I have provoking his people to return to trusting in him and proclaiming his name, God's name. The developed discussion of Genesis, referring to Tim, the developed discussion of Genesis should provoke the need to study, and shows that there's so much more to the Bible, you know, because people think, you know, the Bible is just, you know, that book that they read through and that's it. You know, but there's so much more to the Bible, and it should provoke people to study. And then I have the preterist view of the scriptures is the use of Bible language that needs consideration. And I believe, lastly, I have Genesis work. Adam was assigned, was to teach Adam to create. Necessity is the mother of invention. So basically, Adam was learning new ways and different ways to work, to make his work easier, you know, through through working. You know, you learn things when you work. You know, that's why we have industrial equipment. You know, so that's what I wanted to share. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that, Edward. One thing I think of is Edward's a part of our, and by the way, Edward's been a part of plenty of covenant creation studies. You know, we did, I think of Beyond Creation Science study. We took, it took us 2 weeks to get through one chapter of Beyond Creation Science when we were doing the study. So, you know, there's a lot that needs to be considered and talked about and studied through.
Oh, man.
So Edward's been there. And then even more recently, we went through a series called The Truth Project. And sure enough, their last, second to last session is on work. And Del Tackett, the teacher there, he needs to pick up a copy of Beyond Creation Science. And, you know, obviously focus on the family. They come from a
young earth. Very familiar.
What he goes on to talk about is how work is bad. You know, and obviously we know that, you know, the thorns and the thistles, which you did in your presentation in Missouri, talk about. Most folks tend to think that that's saying that now that Adam sinned, he's going to have to work. You know, and I remember years ago, somebody did say that to me. They said, you know, the fact that we have to sweat now proves that we're still under the curse. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't even, you know, honestly, I hadn't even bumped into covenant creation or even a preterism yet, but I just couldn't wrap my mind around the idea. I was like, what? So wait, we're saying, and you know, I'll say this, when I first had come into Christianity, most of you know I'm a reader. So I read a lot of literature about Christianity, not just the Bible. And I learned about the Protestant work ethic. So for me, a young Christian, I'm reading my Bible and I'm taking in the idea that work is beautiful, that Christians are supposed to be workers in the world, that we're, that's, you know, Jesus sent us out as workers, if you will. So then to hear somebody say to me, well, yeah, Adam sinned and, you know, now work is bad. That's why we have to work.
It's a confusion and a total misunderstanding of the story.
Yeah.
It has terrible effects on life. And then people wonder why their life goes so badly and all kinds of challenges and stuff. And it's like, it becomes a self-reinforcing cycle, you know, almost like a, you know, self-fulfilling prophecy type of thing. Yeah. And it's like, it doesn't have to be that way.
Yeah, that's right. And, you know, people say perspective is everything. I'm going to say perspective is a lot. I'm not going to say it's everything, but perspective is a lot. And if you keep telling yourself that it's horrible that I have to work, I promise you're going to feel horrible that you have to work.
Absolutely.
So, you know, and I think that leads in on that problem. So as Edward was sharing, I just thought about that. And Edward, I want to appreciate your thoughts and that you didn't come into our session thinking that work is a bad thing. As I listen to you share, it seems as though you're
because when people say work is a curse, Adam was given work before the curse.
Amen. Amen.
Well said. Amen. Amen. Thank you, brother.
Amen.
Anyone else want to, I did unmute mics. I see mics are still muted. I'll go ahead and unmute if folks want to jump in there. I can't imagine Dallas doesn't have anything to say about the Bible.
Hi, Dallas.
How's it going, everybody? Yeah, so I'll just reiterate, yeah, how important it is to come to grips with a proper view of Genesis. Like, it doesn't matter if you're a futurist or a preterist or a historicist or if you just like picking it up on the weekends. It doesn't matter. If I were to tell you the entire epic of the book of the Matrix, and we see that in three movie parts, and each part is an epic movie of its own, and you were to pick it up and not understand part one, like, sure, it's still a cool story. You can still get caught up in the ending, but you'll never have any idea what's going on. And it doesn't matter how well you study. You can memorize every single nuance of every structure of every scene that took place, and still you'd have no idea because you have the wrong faulty beginning. And unfortunately, when it comes to the Bible, there's such an easy assumption in our modern age to just go, yeah, I know what heaven and earth is, and just move on, and that's it. And
Genesis, go ahead. I just jump. Another example is Genesis is like the Hobbit to the Lord of the Rings, right? It's like you. It's part of the story. Exactly. Sorry to interrupt you. Just go for it.
Oh, no issue. Absolutely. And then when you tie that into age, like here, let's compare that to Shakespeare. You know, if you were to do the same example with Shakespeare, like these are big giant plays. If you were to take the just the last like 15 acts of a play of Shakespeare, not only will you not figure out what the heck's going on, even though they're still using English, even though they're still using the same grammar, basically the same stanzas, you know, it's not like when we look back at Greek where there's no punctuation, at Hebrew where it's different characters, no punctuation, and we still can't figure out what the heck they were talking about. So we've got to really grow up a little bit in our maturity level and just stop assuming. And I think that's the biggest problem with the conversation of Genesis, is there's so many assumptions and they're comfortable. They seem easy. And once you bite into that, it, for some reason, it's really hard to let go, even though it's obvious. And that, I think, is the biggest and the hardest part of this conversation is we're talking about very obviously, clearly obviously things, but the tradition around them is so heavy. And I think that's one of the big parts of the conversation.
100% agreement there, man. I mean, that's the nutshell right there.
Amen. Yeah, and I
Real fast, may I share that the importance of Genesis is that once you understand the beginning of Genesis, right, and have that foundation, it will help you with your biblical narrative. Because if you don't have a proper biblical narrative, which I was talking about Pastor Michael, you know, you're going to go in directions that you really don't need to be going.
Amen.
right.
I'm also one of those people who would tie in that there's, you know, not necessarily there's ever really bad conversation in the sense of there should always be questions and there should always be answers. But when it comes to Genesis, from a, and that's what's neat coming out of this podcast I'm doing is because we have a gentleman on there who has no biblical history. He's always seen the Christian main view as silly and foolish. And, you know, as much as I, you know, we want to say, you know, we have these great traditions, we have these great ideas, and we got to be sensitive to these, we also got to wake up and realize they do sound silly and they are foolish. And the only people who don't see it that way are people who want it to be not sounding silly and sounding foolish. So those are part of the growing up. We all say we want to be Bereans, like Mike had brought up. We all say we want to, you know, I'm a studier. I'm a worker of the Lord. I test scripture. I do these things. Well, let's do them, you know, instead of just living in that first easy assumption, because, you know, whether we want to hear it or not, it does sound silly to a lot of people. And if we don't take seriously the fact that it's silly to people, we're really kind of just we're playing into that idea of, yeah, I got my head in the sand. I'm the deer. I'm the religious freak. And I don't care what you say. I don't care what you're pointing out, even if it does sound silly. So I think we got to grow up and mature at that point too, because, you know, sure, it's neat that, you know, and I love, you know, how much beyond creation science pushes preterism, because I think that is an integral part of tying in our understanding to Genesis. But we're still listening today with, you know, people argue evolution versus age versus old earth versus young earth, and none of these questions are even dealt with in the Bible.
Right, exactly.
And it's unfortunate because it all comes back down to those basic silly assumptions we walk in and don't question. I don't want to call things silly because it's, I don't want to, you know, disparage anyone where they're at,
Right.
but some things just are silly. And unfortunately, we got to identify him. And at this point, like I was talking with my father-in-law, he said, "But don't you think that that was, you know, a good way to write to children?" I'm like, "Sure, absolutely." But at some point, we need to grow up. And I
And
think that's what we're doing now.
preterists have figured that out on the other issue because, you know, the idea of stars falling and hitting the earth, that's silly. David Chilton called that out in one of his, you know, things out how ridiculously silly futurism is. You know, the idea that the star is gonna fall and hit planet Earth. Come on, guys. I mean, really. So yeah, we're already there. We just need to be more consistent about it.
Well, that's a good point, because like when we look at even the book of Revelation, you know, Just the argument of its timing is silly. Two times in the first three verses, the time statement is told to us. So it's silly that we have to debate this. And I don't want to say silly again, but any other document in the history of the world that starts that way doesn't have this conversation.
Right.
It's just because we've gotten religious about it. So yeah, absolutely. I think that's why there are, as you know, Mike was talking about, anybody who's actually stood up and wanted to say something and say, we need to look at this. That's why you are getting those machine guns pointing back at you, right?
I've used this term a lot. It's covenant creation is heresy squared, right? I mean, you're already heretic on one side. You're a heretic for eschatology. But when you get to Genesis and you're in covenant creation, it's heresy to the, you know, to the two power squared. That's where we are.
Now you've given words for the problem that most people are going to use on the internet. These guys are doubly heretics. Doubly dead, you know, but hey, we'll continue on. And, you know, I want to say that's why I really appreciate, you know, your work, Tim. Obviously, it's been very foundational and it continues to be instrumental in my understanding of the Bible and my understanding of theology, my teaching of the Bible and theology. And of course, Dallas, you know, you've been a good challenge where, you know, it's exciting to know that this isn't just coming from the minds of Tim Martin and Covenant Creation groups, but there's others that are diving into these things and aren't just trying to, you know, me, I would say I'm a student of Tim Martin and Jeff Vaughn, whereas Dallas comes from a sort of different angle and leaning in on these things. And yet here we are able to find similar conclusions, able to find consistency and still say we have more to learn. And that's what, you know, I think is so important. And I'm indebted to both of you, and I thank you for your work in that regard.
What the scriptures say about that verse that talks about not only proving all things, but it talks about to express or tell people how you came to the faith or something of that nature, the scripture says. But anyway, my point being that when you're talking to a new Christian or someone that you're just talking Bible to, you have to believe what you're saying. Mm-hmm. See, when you believe what you're saying, you know, you can express it and you can develop thoughts in a manner that's coherent.
Yeah, amen. Amen. I'm not sure what you were asking about the came to the faith. I'm thinking Galatians, something there in Galatians, but I'm not sure what exactly you were highlighting, Edward. I'm not sure if anyone.
What comes to mind when I hear that is the always be prepared with an answer for the reason why you believe. Yes. And I would have to say, yes, we have to be, but we have to be more than belief, because I think, and I'll just challenge you to push you forward in the way you express that a little differently there, Edward, because I think you agree. Yes, belief is great, but we get a lot of beliefs handed to us that we just assume that once we challenge them, our beliefs might change. So what I would say is belief, and you will always say this on the other side of this, so I know you agree with this, which is the belief backed by understanding. Like, yeah. You want to understand why you believe what it is you're saying. And I think you meant to say that. I just wanted to point that out.
Yes, because you have to be able to prove it through scripture. You know, support it through scripture, you know, hopefully.
Amen. I did want to give a moment. I know, Zach, you're here with us. I wanted to at least allow you the opportunity to unmute if you wanted and to chime in here. Don't feel pressured, but if you had something you want to share, please feel invited. All right. And with that, if Zach doesn't unmute, I'm going to go ahead and afford Tim a moment here to just share some closing thoughts.
Before you shut down, do you mind if I throw out one thing?
Yeah. I don't mind at all, brother.
Okay, so this is coming from a place where, yes, I do have a podcast, a YouTube channel, and a Facebook group where we discuss these things. One thing I would like to say, especially even specifically to the preterists, and I know a lot of people will be coming here because Tim's name. So just remember, you know, like Mike had said, this is a new thing. You know, no one here knows what's going on. Nobody's right. This is a giant can of worms, and right now they have been released, and we're all grabbing onto worms. What we got to stop doing to each other is telling each other why we're wrong and start trying to understand why we're saying what we're saying. I've come to understand that just like I understand when we go from futurism to preterism, it usually is through resistance, but through overwhelming time statements or overwhelming use of this word of heaven and earth or overwhelming use, we get bullied into preterism by the overwhelming weight of the scripture. Genesis conversation isn't going that way. Genesis conversation being a start, there's a lot more development of understanding coming from the whole scope of scripture that has to be put back into Genesis. So what I'm going to just simply say in summing this all up is, remember, we're coming to a place where we know something is here. We know something needs to be harvested out of what we're doing. But we can't do that by telling each other how wrong we are. We have to open up the conversation and make it free, make it available to be wrong. We're not going to find the answers to questions if we don't go to the end of the trails. And we can't go to the end of those trails if people are shouting at the signs of the trails as being wrong. We have to go all the way through some of these things, even if we don't like what they sound like at the beginning. Because, and just like with Mike, and I love that you brought up that simple in the beginning, something as simple as those three words has changed Mike's view in some aspects of how the Bible begins, how the Bible interchanges at the New Testament, simply three words. And this is a person who's put in massive amounts of educated study and still sat down and learned and was able to say, look, I'm learning. Let us all take from that character and say, you know what? This is new. I might not understand it. I might not like it, but we got to talk about it and we can't censor one another. We got to do it in love. That's all I have to say about it. Taking advantage of Tim's name, and I know a lot of those people in this conversation are going to be part of this, so let's keep the love up.
Well said. And, you know, I have one more question I want to put out there. And, Tim, this is mainly to you, and it was from the online forum there. And then I'll afford you opportunity. Please answer the question and then share your closing
okay.
with us. And this was from Rick Carter on our – he's watching live, so – you know, one of the boroughs of Berea there. He's appreciative of the shirt. He said he loves the shirt, of course. And what Rick said was, let me just double back to the, I was having a little bit of a conversation with him here. What if Genesis chapter 1 was written at a later date, that the original writing started with chapter 2 first? And if you want to share your thoughts on that, and then please share with us your closing thoughts.
Well, there is the idea that Genesis 1 was written during the Babylonian captivity, or at least, you know, produced as we have it today. But I think most scholarship would assume or has claimed that Genesis 1, 2, and 3 come from the same period of time. So I guess there'd have to be some way of sort of like having evidence to figure out why that's broken up. And it certainly doesn't, you know, I would say that from my perspective, that looks like the flow is perfectly matching a covenant temple dedication text, going from the big picture in Genesis chapter 1 to the inner courts with Adam as God's first priest. So there's a thematic issue there, a flow of Genesis 1 through 3 that'd be very difficult to split up. I mean, I guess suppose if the scholars are right that it's written in Babylonian captivity, you know, if that can be demonstrated, you know, without controversy or whatever, then we go with it. But I don't believe that that's been established. And I think there's actually more evidence the other way. That's actually a very old view that kind of predates some of the discoveries of the ancient Near East. P.J. Wiseman and ancient records is showing that that's higher criticism stuff that was, you know, making it up as it went. So that's my view of that. As far as a conclusion to bring this to a close, you know, I just want to emphasize how important biblical literacy is in all of this. I think that a lot of people make assumptions about what the Bible says and doesn't say, and they don't spend the time to really, you know, eat, digest the word, right? So I just wanted to give our critics and those who are investigating what this all means, I would say, if this makes you go back to the scriptures and read the prophets and read the law and read Genesis in a, you know, in a more intense way, you're going to be better off anyway. It's going to help your biblical literacy, and that's going to be that's going to show fruit in a lot of ways, because the scriptures feed faith. They're one of God's ways of feeding faith. And so I think that's my biggest thing. And I didn't mention before, but I've got 18 years worth of sermons where, you know, I worked with a congregation for 18 years preaching to really sort of, my goal was always to bring them into the knowledge of the story of scripture in the details and the stories and the books. You know, I did, you know, series through exegetical preaching through different books and stuff. And I learned a great deal from that myself. So it was a, you know, there are some side benefits that some byproducts of that, but I'm hoping to put those sermons up so that people can consider that there are, you know, resources out there for heavy biblical studies, because I want to emphasize that to people. That's really important in this theology stuff. I think preterists understand that at a certain level, because we've been forced into the word when it comes to eschatology studies. But that is true of a lot of different parts of the Bible, not just the prophecy stuff.
Amen. Amen. And of course, I want to encourage folks, there's plenty of resources out there that, you know, you can get your hands on. I'm going to be digging up the Covenant Creation conferences. I want to encourage folks to review them, get a handle on some of the things that have already been detailed and said. Take notes. You know, that's what I do. That's what I encourage folks to do. That way things don't need to constantly be repeated. If you took the notes the first time, they wouldn't need to be repeated again and again. So, and by the way, Tim, I wanted to thank you for the way that you answered that question that Rick had brought up. My immediate reaction was, why and how would I arrive there, you know, at that conclusion? And, you know, Rick had mentioned that this is some conversation the boroughs of Berea are looking to develop soon. So that's great. We're cross-pollinating right there. And I look forward to leaning in on their resources and seeing how this conversation, you know, we'll pull Dallas's resources in, we'll pull Tim's resources, we'll pull the boroughs of Berea in, and we'll just keep pulling people. John Walton, we mentioned, Don Preston. Before you know it, we're at the dance.
Yeah, we're at the big dance. At the big dance.
Amen. That's beautiful. And Tim, thank you very much for being here with us tonight. As a matter of closing, I just want to share a couple things. We're not done having review of the Ask the Pastor Conference, and we're not done with our review of the Kingdom and Worldview Conference. So I do have some other guests that are going to be joining with us. I know Nathan Tippy was a speaker there at the Ask the Pastor Conference, and I know he has some different thoughts regarding covenant creation. I might poke him a bit when we bring him on the program to share with me some of his qualms and questions, and there you go, more cross-pollinating being done. So look forward to a discussion with him. He brought forth a great presentation on Sunday morning that I felt needs to be at least five presentations. So I'm going to be bringing Nathan on to have some conversations with him in the next couple weeks. Also, Johnny Ova and Jason D'Ambrosio, they gave exhortations at at the Kingdom and Worldview Conference. They're from the Sound of Heaven Church here on Long Island. They don't call themselves a preterist church. They're more of a fulfilled eschatology church. We'll get them there. No, just kidding. That being said, they're a great congregation. Them brothers have a lot to share. There were two quips that I might encourage you with tonight. The first one was to search the scriptures as if you're looking for your keys. Think about that. I don't know about you. I lose my keys a lot. I know what it feels like to lose my keys and to really spend time looking for them. Spend time in the scriptures. And then the other one that Jason had charged us with was to devour the scriptures in a manner that you're eating for two. Everything you've learned here, God has blessed you with so that you might bless other people with. So I encourage you, eat for two. And those are some quips that you're going to hear more about as we talk with Jason and Johnny. And then, of course, we're always planning more and more interviews on our program. I do, at the beginning of the year, usually begin my Bible over. So that's why we've made it a customary thing here to, you know, bring on Tim and have coveting creation conversations, creation or Genesis conversations at the end or the beginning of the year. So obviously I'll encourage you to look forward to that. And then there was something I wanted to mention in closing here. Either way, I'll just finish with my notes that I have in front of me. I do want to encourage you to visit Dallas's podcast, Challenging the Traditions of Men. I think it was episode 11 that we had done recently, and it was great to be a part of that. Episode 11. All right, great. I was looking for Dallas in my back room here to make sure.
Yeah, you were on episode 10 with me. So if you're a big fan of Mike Miano, jump over to episode 10 where we get into In the Beginning.
There we go. Good deal. And I believe you've continued it since then, right?
Yeah, we took that idea that we started with In the Beginning and seeing how when we transitioned into the New Testament, how the narrative Jesus, and we just continued into that understanding of how that language also is duplicated with creation language, which is neat because Genesis starts with in the beginning, God created, and Jesus is in the beginning was described by a new creation. So we continued that language.
Cool. All right. Here I was. I thought we were going to do the first four words of the Bible, the first five words of the Bible. That would have been
we got two more episodes slotted on in the beginning before we can move into created.
Good deal. Well, I want to encourage folks, go ahead and visit Dallas's podcast. I'll be sharing a link for that in the near future. I mentioned Larry Siegel and the Portland Church of Christ. You can go to their YouTube channel and gain some resources from them that you'll definitely be blessed by. And then I want to give us homework. Our homework is to learn and look into what Max King had taught about Genesis. And, to use this as a catalyst for study. We're not, seeking to, make people feel bad that, oh, look what you didn't know back in 1970 or whatever it is. But rather, using this as a catalyst to say, well, how can we chase after consistency?
Right.
And also, as I mentioned, I'll be the one to mention it. I'd encourage you to do it with Don Preston's resources. I think Don has a little bit more about Genesis that might help you, lean in on and maybe even see some of the problems. And gain some consistency there. So there's homework for you. We don't have any dates set up yet except for our last Friday of the month. That's our next specific date that we'll be here live at the Preterist Power Hour. However, as I mentioned, I'm working on some interviews, so those are going to be coming up. Tim, again, thank you for your time tonight.
Thank you for the invite, Michael, and I'm looking forward to a great future.
Amen.
I appreciate your ministry, particularly with a congregation. I have a special love for that. Guys that are hanging themselves out there in congregational ministry, I can't tell you what kind of respect I have for your work in the kingdom, because that's so important. Just want you to know that.
Thank you. Amen. I happen to believe Christ has deposited his life in the church, and we still need that institution to be alive and well. So thank you for that. Tim, not only do I need you to teach me how to dance if I show up to the dance, I'm also going to ask you to close us out in a word of prayer.
Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you, Lord, for what you've blessed us with, the many, many blessings of friendships and fellowship and time together. I thank you for this time that we've had to discuss your word and your beautiful, amazing, majestic work of salvation that you've done for us in Jesus Christ. We just pray that you give us strength as we apply that to the world around us, and that we'd see the fruit that you provide for us in that effort, that the work of our hands would be very fruitful in all of the kingdom and endeavors that you've put in front of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, brother. God bless. Go in peace and remember Pella.